Professor Dave and Chegg here. We just learned about the types of atomic orbitals that the electrons in an atom can inhabit. The specific arrangement of electrons amongst the orbitals within an atom is called the electron configuration of the atom. Many properties of an element will depend on its electron configuration, so let's make sure we understand these now.
The convention for reporting an electron configuration is to list all the types of orbitals that are occupied along with a number to indicate the occupancy of those particular orbitals. Each item in an electron configuration should have the n value, followed by the letter that corresponds to the type of orbital, and a superscript that describes the number of electrons contained in that subshell. So this would be read 2p4, which refers to a total of 4 electrons that exist in the 2p orbitals. Let's make sure we understand that neither of these two numbers is telling us how many orbitals are being described, as that number is implied, since each energy level contains 1 s orbital, 3 p orbitals, and 5 d orbitals. This is what dictates the maximum numbers allowed for the superscript values, since any atomic orbital can hold a maximum of 2 electrons, according to the Pauli exclusion principle. As we said, the electron configuration of an atom tells us a lot about what kind of chemistry it will do, so we must learn how to write these explicitly for any element. We can write the electron configuration for an atom by filling atomic orbitals until all the electrons in an atom have a place to stay. We will fill up each subshell completely before going up to the next one that's higher in energy, and the order we will use is dictated by the Aufbau principle. In German, Aufbau means to build up, and that's exactly what we are doing when determining the electron configuration of an atom. We are starting with the lowest energy orbital, the 1s, and building up to the higher energy orbitals until all the electrons are assigned to an orbital. It may be difficult to remember the order of the orbitals by looking at them in this way, so this diagram with each type of orbital together in one column shows us an easy way to remember the correct order to fill up the subshells. We just follow an arrow and then jump down to the next one. An even more convenient way to follow the Aufbau principle is to simply know what sections on the periodic table correspond to which subshells. Looking at the periodic table now, we must understand that each period, or row, on the table represents a shell, or a particular n value. The first row is n equals 1, then n equals 2, and so forth. Then we must know that this section containing groups 1 and 2 is called the s block. This section is the p block. The transition metals are the d block, and the lanthanides and actinides are the f block, though we won't be too concerned with f orbitals here. The only trick is that the D block is always one behind the period number in terms of principal quantum number, and the F block is always two behind. We can see that in the fourth period, it's actually the 3D orbitals that follow the 4S, and in the sixth period, the order is 6S, then 4F, then 5D, then 6P. The S and P orbitals will both match the period number, which will equal the principal quantum number. The Ds are one behind, and the Fs are two behind. If we can internalize this way of looking at the periodic table, then the Aufbau principle reveals itself as we simply read left to right and up to down on the table. Starting at the top left corner, the order would be 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 4s, 3d, 4p, and so forth, which is precisely the order dictated by the Aufbau principle. This will make it much easier for us to assign electron configurations to any atom. As we begin to explicitly write out electron configurations, let's also learn how to draw orbital diagrams, because the ability to visualize orbital diagrams will make the electron configurations of an atom more than just a set of letters and numbers. It will allow us to visualize the arrangement of electrons within an atom. That's what orbital diagrams are. They are visual representations of electron configurations, showing each individual orbital and the number of electrons inside them. Let's start with the simplest atom, hydrogen. We will use a box to represent the 1s orbital, which is the lowest energy orbital, so that one gets filled first. Since hydrogen has only one electron, we will use a single-headed arrow to symbolize that one electron, and we will arbitrarily give it a spin-up value, or plus 1/2. Every electron will be either spin-up or spin-down, so the arrows will all be either up or down to reflect the spin. So hydrogen has an electron configuration of 1s1. Let's do the next element, helium. Neutral helium has 2 electrons. Well, every orbital, including this 1s orbital, can accommodate 2 electrons. So let's put the new electron in there as well, but this time spin down. It must be spinned down because these two electrons will have the same values for n, l, and m sub l, so they must have opposite spin so as not to violate the Pauli exclusion principle. Helium is therefore 1s2. Next, we have lithium. Lithium has three electrons, so the first two will go in the 1s orbital, but once that is full, we will have to move to the 2s orbital, as that is the next orbital we fill according to the Aufbau principle. The last electron goes there, so we have 1s2, 2s1. Beryllium will have the 1s orbital and 2s orbital full. Now we enter the 2p subshell, which will be represented by three boxes, since there are three of these orbitals. For the elements from boron to neon, we can see a demonstration of Hund's rule. Once again, this rule tells us that for a set of degenerate orbitals, or orbitals of equal energy, like these three 2p orbitals, we must fill them up one at a time before doubling them up. That's why, as we add one additional electron per element, we can see them being arranged within the orbitals in this fashion. So boron, carbon, and nitrogen will have unpaired 2p electrons, and then starting with oxygen, we begin to double them up, until we get to neon, which has this subshell completely full. We can show the orbital diagram for any atom in this way. We simply depict the relevant orbitals as boxes, filling them up according to the Aufbau principle, and for the last few electrons, we follow Hund's rule. We should now be able to assign the electron configuration of any element by following the Aufbau principle. This is easy to do if we simply look at where an element sits on the periodic table and list off the subshells that the element will utilize by going left to right and up to down on the table until we get to the element in question. Take chlorine, for example. In order to get to chlorine, let's start up at the top left corner and read off the subshells. 1s will be full, so 1s2. Same with 2s, so 2s2 and 2p6 from period 2. Then 3s2, and when we get to the 3p orbitals, we count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to get to chlorine, 3p5. That gives us 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p5 as the electron configuration for chlorine. This makes perfect sense, as neutral chlorine has 17 electrons to place, and this is the lowest energy configuration for the distribution of these 17 electrons. One more thing to point out about electron configurations and orbital diagrams has to do with how electrons are paired. If an element has unpaired electrons in its orbital diagram, it is said to be paramagnetic. This will cause the substance to experience an attraction to a magnetic field. By contrast, if all of the electrons in the orbital diagram are paired, this substance is said to be diamagnetic and will be weakly repelled by a magnetic field. We should also briefly mention the most common exceptions to this method of assigning electron configuration. Take copper, for example. Following the method we just described, after getting through the electron configuration up to argon, we would expect to assign 4s2 and then 3d9, if we were simply going from left to right. However, the ground state electron configuration involves a valence shell of 4s1, 3d10. Why is this? It has to do with how extremely close in energy the 4s and 3d orbitals are. Given the fact that when a subshell is either half full or completely full, there is a slight stabilizing effect. The enhanced stability of promoting a 4s electron up to the 3d orbitals to get a full 3d subshell outweighs the energy difference between the orbitals. So the atom will be at a lower energy by adopting this configuration. Thus, this is the ground state electron configuration. All the common exceptions will be similar in that they involve the promotion of one of the electrons in an s orbital up to the adjacent d orbitals to get either a half full or completely full subshell. So below copper we have silver, which is 5s1 4d10, and below that is gold, which is 6s1 4f14 5d10. For the half-full d subshell elements, that's chromium, 4s1 3d5, and molybdenum, 5s1 4d5. And one other common exception that is slightly different is palladium, which manages to promote both of its outermost 5s electrons to get 4d10. We can now begin to see the reasoning for the structuring of the periodic table. Elements that are in groups together were placed as such on the basis of exhibiting similar behavior. It turns out that they do so because they have similar electron configurations, specifically that they have the same number of valence electrons, which are the electrons in the outermost shell. In group 1, all the configurations end in S1. In group 2, they end in S2. You can see that in every group, the electron configurations end the same way as the other elements in that group. So as we move forward and learn about the periodic table, it is the number of valence electrons that will determine the reactivity and properties of any particular element, as the valence electrons are the ones that are available to do chemistry. Those electrons that are not in the outermost shell and are therefore not valence electrons are called core electrons. These are the ones in the inner shells, which do not participate in chemistry. So most elements have many core electrons and just a few valence electrons, particularly as we get lower on the table.
With electron configurations and their relationship with the periodic table understood, we are now ready to take a deeper dive into the periodic table to discuss the many trends we can find within. Professor Dave for Chegg. See you next time.